I only knew one thing, and it's indeed a single idea. If you compare these big pharmaceutical players, and we know in this COVID time today that these people, these companies are very important for the health on our planet. Mm-hmm. If we compare them with each other on issues that the world thinks is very important, then things will move. That's the only thing I knew. And I thought I need a credible comparison between these companies on issues like, do they do research to neglected diseases? Do they do research for new antibiotics? Do they price their medicine for the rich people, but also for the poor people? Do they go into the underdeveloped countries to find the people to work on the issue of getting them access to medicine?
Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a podcast and video show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. If you're new to the channel, please subscribe and hit the bell icon. I'm your host, Frits Bussemaker, and today I'm delighted and privileged to have a conversation with Wim Breerveld. Wim, welcome to the show.
Hi, Frits. Hi.
Hi. Now, to give a little bit of background on who Wim Breerveld is, he has a background in the pharma industry. He's the co-founder of PMSI and Walsh International, leading providers of the information services to the health industry. Both Walsh and PMSI became listed to NASDAQ. But a couple of years ago, Wim was inspired by a single idea: how can we encourage the pharmaceutical industry, which has such a huge potential in changing the world, to do more to help the world's poorest people to gain access to medicine? You have to realize that over 2 billion people at the time still lack access to basic medicine. Now, that led to the idea to create the Access to Medicine Index. Now, we will be talking with him about the Access to Medicine Index, where the first results were published in 2008, and it was recently ranked among the world's top most credible sustainability rankings. He's also the founder and chair of the World Benchmarking Alliance, which has resulted of the successful Access to Medicine Index. So Wim, again, welcome to the show. First, let me start off with the question, what is the Access to Medicine Index?
Hi, Frits, the Access to Medicine Index is a list of the 20 biggest pharmaceutical companies. Mm-hmm. And it's listing according to how do they treat the people who at this moment don't have access to medicine. And like you said in your introduction, 2 billion people today don't have access to their medicine. No drug for pain, no simple antibiotic, it's simply not there. So how can we organize big pharma to play a bigger role? And the index is, it compares these companies with each other, and the top of the list, the company who's topping the list, is the best performer. And it's the principle is that it creates competition between these companies to do better. They learn from each other how to reach these unprivileged people.
Okay, I can understand the dream and the concept. But first, let me get to you, ask you, what inspired you to begin this in the first place?
Well, I must say it started with 9/11, you know, New York. It was for all a moment we never forget.
Yeah.
And people asked me, you know, after that event, Wim, how do you look at it? And I always said, well, we cannot build our world leaving so many people behind. So the difference between rich and poor will hurt us. And then I realized, what is my role? What can I do about this issue? And that's what made me, in fact, made me active to find out my role and to work on the big pharmaceutical companies, which I knew so well. You know, I worked for more than 15 years. They were my clients. So I knew them very well. And I thought I have to bring them on a path towards the people who don't have access.
I understand that dream, which is very worthwhile. And you mentioned just, you described what the access to medicine index X is. But how do you get attention? Because if you, I know there are a lot of publications on all these topics, but what did you do to make sure it got attention, that people are actually doing something with that information?
Yeah. Fritz, I must say, I didn't know beforehand. I didn't know whether it would get attention, not at all. I must say, I spent 2 to 3 years every day thinking I might fail. Mm-hmm. In fact, I failed for more than 2 years, because every week there was perhaps 4 to 5 moments where I should say to myself, well, I should stop. It's not going to work. So first of all, I was not sure this would work. I only knew one thing, and it's indeed a single idea. If you compare these big pharmaceutical players, and we know in this COVID time today that these people, these companies are very important for the health on our planet. Mm-hmm. If we compare them with each other on issues that the world thinks is very important, then things will move. That's the only thing I knew. And I thought I need a credible comparison between these companies on issues like, do they do research to neglected diseases? Do they do research for new antibiotics? Do they price their medicine for the rich people, but also for the poor people? Do they go into the underdeveloped countries to find the people to work on the issue of getting them access to medicine? And all those details were questioned to all these companies, and to find out where were the differences, and where were companies failing, and where were they successful.
Okay, now you approached the pharmaceuticals directly for this information?
Well, that's what I did, but in the beginning, they were not, let's say, very interested to answer my questions.
Yeah, I very much imagine that. If you're a single individual, who's Wim Lerenfeld, who's the Access to Medicine Index?
So yes, who the hell is... Yeah. So they were not interested, but I had some people around me, an organization who thought that they could not deny all my questions and all my hard work. So mm-hmm. some people said, we are going to help this guy.
Yeah.
And in fact, before I made the first Access to Medicine Index in 2008, companies were not, let's say, willing to give me the data. So we did it, all the data we got out of public sources. We, on Google, you can find a lot, you know, on the internet.
Yeah.
And that's the way we compared. And some companies saw our work, and they were willing to adapt or to correct, to revise the information we sent to them. So the first index I got after 5 years of hard work, and that's part of your question, in the Financial Times, which was very important.
Yes. Okay, so that's Financial Times spent gave you some exposure, and I know that since then more international news outlets picked up the Access to Medicine Index. So you got coverage. Still, the question bears: so what? Why would the pharmaceutical industry do something with that report, that index?
Yes. Well, I got a report first with all sorts of information, how they failed, some companies failed, and how companies were successful in reaching the poor.
Yes.
But what I did first is I tried to organize a consensus of what we asked from all these companies. Mm-hmm. Because if you ask the World Health Organization, they have a different opinion what to expect from pharmaceutical companies than, for example, organizations like Oxfam or Medicine Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, or the United Nations, and also the companies themselves and governments, they disagree with each other what they want from Big Pharma for the poor. So the pharmaceutical industry could get away without answering to all the people, all the questions, because there was simply no agreement, no consensus what we want from the company. So when I organized a sort of consensus what to expect from big pharmaceutical companies, then they could not simply deny saying, well, this is not worthwhile because this is what the world wanted from these companies. So they have to accept that this was done by hard work and by people who knew the world, even the investor, the big London investor community we involved, asking their opinion, what they wanted from big pharma in developing countries. So they were involved as well. And that was the reason why all my lobby work to two papers, the Financial Times and the New York Times, why they became interested in this concept. And perhaps, Fritz, maybe it's interesting when I say that, some people never understand why this works, but some people immediately understand. And I was lucky that in 2008, in July 2008, when this index was published in the Financial Times, the Financial Times had two articles, one about the index itself and one about me. I was happy about that. The same day, the chair of the Wellcome Trust, one of the biggest foundations in the world, was traveling in his plane towards his friend, mm-hmm. Bill Gates, okay. Like he told me later. And on the same moment when he arrived, he said to me, he gave the paper, the Financial Times in front of Bill. And he said, have you seen this, Bill? And can you imagine that first day the index was published, those two, Sir William Castle and Bill Gates, decided to copy this idea. The rest are you're going to follow in my interview perhaps later. But that was a very important moment that the Financial Times and later the New York Times, those two important papers covered this index.
That's an amazing story of a lot of hard work combined with a little bit of serendipity, that
yes,
somebody just happened yes. to be on a plane to Bill Gates. Because yes. I read an interview somewhere that Bill Gates calls this capitalism 2.0.
Yes.
Yes. So it's an alignment of trying to build a better world, but also providing, making better companies, running a good company.
Yeah. Well, in fact, what I like it, as you know, because how did I do the idea? There is no other index like this. But what was, of course, very helpful is that Bill Gates recognized this, because he recognized immediately that this was something that was combining profit, for these companies. Because when you develop your business in developing countries, you see that these developing countries are really building their economy. Yeah. And at the end, it's an interesting market. So Bill Gates recognized the principles of the combination of purpose and profit.
Excellent. Okay. And I also read somewhere that Mary Robertson of the United Nations, High Commissioner, former President of Ireland, also stated that this is actually much better than the job we as a UN nations did. So a lot of praise from very influential people. Did that create, you have to work with these international organizations to get things done. At the time you were a small entity. How did that, influence the relationship? Did they treat you seriously? Thank you very much. We're going to take your idea, and now the big boys are going to work.
Your question is whether the pharmaceutical industry
yes.
Used or is
yes. So in 2000, yeah. So 2008, first index. It got a positive response. The people were a little bit reluctant to help you with that information. I know you've since then produced more reports, more indexes. So what happened afterwards? What did it affect on the second one?
Yes, well, realize that when the first one was published, the first Access to Medicine Index was published in 2008 in the Financial Times, you think a lot will change. Well, nothing happened. Nothing. Nothing at all. And I was, in fact, worried. I didn't know, you know, about Bill Gates. He was activist because what happened later after 1 or 2 years, it was he presented this as if it was his idea, which I completely, you know, I thought it's okay. But wherever he was in the world, he said he was discussing about the index as if he had a new idea. Because what happened is that pharmaceutical industry wanted, they said, well, this is interesting, but our rating, you know, perhaps 17 out of 20, for example, Merck was 17 out of 20, whilst they always told their people, their employees, we are a leader.
Yeah.
Yes. In the first index, you know, the Merck Darmstadt was, in fact, the 17th company on the list of 20, which was to them not good enough and not according to how they saw the world. So they started to increase their efforts and to adapt their policies and practices in developing countries. And other companies did that as well, you know, because they saw that the index was not that popular yet, but they anticipated on the fact that it would make a difference to investors to take this index very serious. And of course, I was helped by you know, by big players, by the effect, by the investor world, a growing amount of investors. Now, I mean, most of the investors, they accept the Access to Medicine Index and they treat companies how they are, what their rating is on the index.
Mm-hmm.
But it was not done in a few months. It was not done in a year. But during the years, the index became more and more effective and prominent and important for these companies. So even enemies of these companies, and these companies have enemies as well, don't worry about it. It's still the gap, you know, there is between their reputation and who they are is still big. But you see that during the years, these companies improved their policies and practices substantially. It was recognized by the World Health Organization and also by the United Nations. And that's why, like Bill Gates suggested today, this principle of a social index is now adopted by the World Benchmarking Alliance. We founded, and that's doing these indices also for the oil world, for the mining sector, for the seed sector, for the IT sector, because this is a way to reach the Sustainable Development Goals, to help companies reach the Sustainable Development Goals.
Okay, so the key solution is that positive correlation between the Sustainability Development Goals and the fact that actually you are also running a good company.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Well, you know, it was not based on bashing companies. It was based on the fact that people are proud for the company they work in.
Okay. So the Access to Medicine Index demonstrated a positive correlation, and you already referred to the World Benchmarking Alliance. So can we assume that if you start to measure people or organizations on their contribution to the Sustainable Development Goals, that there's always that positive correlation?
Well, at this moment, it is not. You can't be CEO of a company, of a big multinational, mm-hmm. without looking at the development of our climate, of our world. It's not every CEO yet, but on questions that people raise, what is the purpose of your company? What is the profit of your company? But how do you measure profit? Profit is not only profit in money. Profit is also what you mean for the development of our earth. What do you mean for our climate? And more CEOs, they cannot let's say, do their business without showing that they care about the development of our Earth. That's changing, but it's still not enough, not at all.
Well, you've shown already a lot of progress throughout the years, what you've done with for medicine, for healthcare, and do hope that the World Benchmarking Alliance will do the same for other industries. So you mentioned a couple of industries. Which are the key industries you are looking at from the World Benchmarking Alliance at the moment?
Yes, at this moment, that's not covered in the World Benchmarking Alliance. The Access to Medicine Index is separate.
Yeah.
But that's in this COVID time, that's a very important one. No yes. doubt. Without health, I mean, our world is over.
Yes.
The real world. Yeah. Our world changed substantially because of COVID. But okay, that's number one. But then you have, of course, the oil companies, the mining companies. Those are and the most important one is the Apples and the Googles of this world. You know, Apple and Google, they do a lot, but how do they see their role? They have responsibility, and they hardly, I must say, still, they hardly understand that their power is sometimes more intensive than the president of the United States.
I think we're feeling that on a daily basis. If you look at, we use these platforms on a daily basis.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Well, in fact, the president of the United States has only a 4-year term.
Yes.
Yes, but the CEO of these companies they go on for a much longer period. And they can decide, you know, when the president doesn't do well, to skip them from Twitter or, you know, from the social media. I mean, it's amazing. And that's another discussion, of course. But it's very important that these companies understand that they have a role to build our planet.
That's, I think, a very important lesson and message to share with the world. Hey, You can actually do good, but bring doing good in alignment with running a good company.
Yeah. So IT is the most important sector, but and then it's the oil and then the food companies like the Unilevers, the Danone, and the Nestle's. Yes.
Okay.
They're all covered in the World Benchmarking Alliance.
Okay. So in this context, what does success for you mean? Also, as an individual, as a person.
Well, it's very personal, of course, because without success, I will keep on going. So I cannot breathe when I don't, let's say, try to get success. I want to play my role in the world. And this index, it costs, and like I said in the beginning of this interview, it cost me years to see whether I had success. Every day I could fail, and without success, for me, there is no reason to go on living. So that doesn't mean I have success always, because that's definitely not true. I made failures, I made substantial failures, but also failures made me more sharp in my life.
Oh, can you give an example of your biggest failure?
Yeah.
Million is
called. Oh, terrible. Yeah. I think I never forget Fritz, because I had my knowledge about the index before the index was there. Mm-hmm. I thought I knew how I had a 15 years experience in the pharmaceutical industry, so I knew this world more than anyone else. And I neglected here a bit to do more research in the industry, in today's industry, because I was asked by the World Health Organization to present my idea about an index. Well, that is, of course, an amazing opportunity for a man with a single idea.
Yes.
So I went to Geneva to do my presentation, but I must say I had to prepare myself much better, because there I was rather, bold about the industry, and I didn't realize that the leaders of this industry were in this room of okay. presentation. I didn't realize that. So I made some remarks which made them stood up and made them immediately kill my idea. In fact, what happened was on a high stage, the World Health Organization, the idea of an access to medicine index was killed by my presentation. The only thing what happened was that it was in the morning, then lunchtime came, and when I had the lunch, I felt very lonely, Fritz. I felt very lonely in the World Health Organization. I got my lunch. But what happened was, during lunchtime, some companies went my way. They went to sit with me, and they tried to ask more questions to me. And I thought, well, I might have failed. I did fail. But I still think I have something in my hands. And my failure made me stronger. My failure made, because, you know, I thought I won't give up, because I knew that I got Big Pharma, you know, I got them by comparing them with each other on these important issues.
Yeah, sounds like you tripped a little bit, but you picked yourself up, laser focused, and you got it done.
Yes. Okay. Yes, that's right. But it took perhaps an extra year. Can you imagine? Yes.
That single presentation took an extra year to get it done.
Yes.
Okay.
I think so.
That's a very good lesson for everybody. Yes. I think in any circumstances, be prepared. Hey, my last question to you, Wim. How do you want the world to remember you?
Yeah, Fritz, that I played my role. That's all. You know, if I play a game, I just want to be there. I don't have to win always. I don't have to win always, but as long as I am playing, and I always wanted to play on a world level, I think I do that today, but that's, you know, that I did my job. I did my job in the development of our planet. It's a small job. It is a small one, but it's just how I want to be remembered. It's just that I did my role.
Yeah.
I did my role.
Well, Wim, thank you very much for that answer. And, from my side, I think you are very much doing your role, doing your part to create a better world. So, again, I'm very honored that you made time to for this interview, for this chat, or for the brand called you. So, Wim, wish you all the best with the Access to Medicine Index and the World Benchmarking Alliance. And no doubt we'll hear soon more about what that will lead to. So, again, thank you very much.
Thank you, Fritz. It was fun. Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Thank you for listening to The Brand Called You videocast and podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website, www.tbcy.in, to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for The Brand Called You.